few commentators surveying the political scene in the British Isles in the summer of 1637 would have concluded that Charles's rule was likely to be seriously threatened in the foreseeable future. By August 1640, Scotland had been in a state of rebellion for nearly 2 years. Two English military campaigns to end the revolt had ended in failure. Northern England had been invaded, and Newcastle was an occupied city. This required Charles to summon his first parliament in 11 years, which moved to chastise the king with a grand remonstrance, a list of grievances relating to the preceding period of personal rule. What had led to this dramatic unravelling of the political status quo? Charles was driven by desire to establish uniformity in religious belief and practice across his three kingdoms, based on Arminianism. The Armenians were a group within the Church of England that had gained royal favour with their calls for return to ceremony and ritual, strict obedience to the king as head of the church, and episcopacy, that is, a church governed by bishops. To many of the more Puritan Protestants who had gained influence during James's reign, this looked dangerously similar to Catholicism. While never a mass movement, the Armenian program advanced steadily after William Laud was made Archbishop of Canterbury in 1633. In 1635, Charles imposed a new set of ecclesiastical canons or rules on the Scottish Church, followed in 1637 by a new prayer book. Both drew heavily from their English equivalents. Scottish opinion was not considered, and protests against these reforms were either ignored or suppressed. This was in contrast to the Balancing Act achieved by Charles's father, James, among whose greatest achievements, according to Barry Coward, was finding a middle way between Scottish Presbyterianism, a system of church government by local assemblies and the leadership of bishops. Violent demonstrations followed after the introduction of the new prayer book, with women often playing a leading role. On the 23rd of July, 1637, at St. Giles's Church, Edinburgh, Mr. William Annan was reported to have faced abuse from women who, with fists and staves and peats but no stones, beat him sore. Similarly, the Bishop of Brechin was forced to protect himself while reading from the prayer book by pointing loaded pistols at his congregation. Charles remained inflexible. In response, an organised petitioning movement gathered support, and in November 1637, a representative body was elected. The following February, at Greyfriars Church, Edinburgh, a religious manifesto called the National Covenant was drawn up. Subscribers of the manifesto undertook an oath that called for religion to remain in the form that it had existed in 1580, rejecting all innovations introduced since. Whilst not rejecting episcopacy outright, it substantially undermined it. For a short period, Charles withdrew the new prayer book, but he refused to contemplate its permanent suppression, declaring instead, "I mean to be obeyed." In November 1638, faced with a king unwilling to compromise, the Covenanters' position became more radical, abolishing Scottish bishops and establishing Presbyterianism as the national religion. This was a direct challenge to Charles's authority. Like his father, who 30 years previously had said, "No bishops, no king," Charles saw this as something that could ultimately lead to the end of hereditary monarchy. With both sides unwilling to give ground, the slide to armed rebellion and war began.